See, you know what I'm saying?
Chilling, we're so glad it at Honor the Dear Ya with we. Happy Black History Month. But you know who we be. We be Gullah Geechee, the anointed people. So every day for we celebrate who we be. Right in the shaline of the Gullah Geechee from Jacksonville, North Kakalaki, down in Jacksonville, Florida, up on Orlesia, Sea Islands and things like that. Oh, and then Red of Was, all the way inland. 30 to 35 miles and thing like that. Or to the St. John River, or Honachilan, you done talk about we the fruit that come from the root. And for plenty of Honachilan with deal with me, you know I always say, Hona must take care of the root for heal the tree. And if Honachilan, the wonder who this shall be, this shall the Queen Quet, the Gullah Geechee Nation head, pony body. I so glad that Hunter Chillin and joined me and told them not Robbie, but it's 30th episode of zooming in on sustainability. But you know, we could crack we teeth up today on secret thing. And we not play tall, tall. So if you come here for entertainment, you come here for study, for book learning and things like that, for to come down from some paper, you come here for crackiness, this ain't the place for you be. Ain't gonna be safe for this your journey. So if you left out, we ain't gonna mad tall tall. But if you come here for being a sacred circle, respect the circle as we go on into this journey, cause it's more than a show. So this your day, we gonna start off the way we always do for anything sacred what we to do. And right here, we gonna start first by ask everybody virtually for hold your hand, your spirit together in one circle, because we the one nation, one family. And we going to pour libation for all of them will come for we one will bring this year legacy. Now as we going into this year, when we pour for we ancestors them, Yibo, Mandinka, Malinke, Yudiba, Gola, Gizi, Mendi, Temni, Ifi, Ibibio, Adisto, Cree, Yamasi, Usado, we say, Ashe. Gola and Chilan, what were the ancestors of the Gullah Geechee once to get you? Ganesha land and thing like that. But behold upon the tradition and thing we bring you from Alkibulan and thing like that. Count true into his DNA. We put this your day, we say, Ashe. For all our children, we ain't there yet. But then with a kind, we will make sure we bless up the land where we stand. So them hide one place, but then stay. For every day, going forward, no matter what come we go, we say, I share. and for bless up everybody who there this year day, joining this year discussion. A bless up the hand, a bless up the Gullah Geechee line. We pour and we say, Ashe. So now, for all them, a crossover, who have been the healers, who have been the bless up anointed people, this year day, let we take a moment of silence. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. And as we say, yeah, let the church say, amen. Plenty of time when people are coming here to the Gullah Geechee Nation, especially the way I did. If they Yeddi say, honey be Gullah Geechee, plenty of them want, what I want Yeddi about the secret thing amongst we. They always want to know what we got at the Buzzard. Gullah that the Buzzard land, we say, Hona think free, Hona be free. But now, this your day, plenty of them children, and I think free, and I think tall, because they can't see. You can give them amnesia, still can't see. Right of us, none no tall, who we be. And all we take for hold upon we. Culture and we legacy. So this your day when you Yeddi me talk about when I must take care of the root for heal the tree. We grind into the root of who all of we as African children be. The mother Africa, what brought all of we, what got the melanin like Alicia, what other rest of people around the world and buckle him. We should be hard. This your day one thing you can't teeth because God gave me. And look ya, who God bless, no man or woman can cuss. But now honor can cuss on herself. If you go out on forget and vexation, anything like that, then think turn back upon honor. Not upon honor, think the true act. Now see when you live on the righteous side. Oh, honor children, need for a blessed bride. So for plenty time now, when Hona done the step later, thing like that, into the outer severe, so the buckle thing, you think everything about competition. You think everything about this year, money. That ain't waiting for a tall. It's shiny thing to who we be black gold, anointed people. Never let them teeth on us shine. And part of that means you take your gold and tortoise, and in all the glory, and no charm we, in our gear we. And part of that, one thing you're not sure with is your elders, and you're not sure with respect for your elders and your ancestors, because you ain't going to never be blessed. You said, no man has child, no taste, no grace. So these are from the first thing when you cast a certain mantle, and truly the one, what hell is your thing? You had a wisdom coming in when you catch the baby, and shook him, and you look upon him. You know, this year the one we come back. We handle the thing was sacred amongst the family. There ain't no nothing say Google got tall. There ain't no nothing that nobody can write about. Because you have to be right in ya. You have to be right in ya. You have to be right ya. From which one I can see. So this your day, we going to take a sacred journey. This ain't a just no show. It ain't a no play thing. So that's why I ask you for treat them like it is. This is a sacred time, a sacred gathering of the family. So for all 100 children, I crack your teeth like a shut all door. I'll speak like this so that you can overstand me. As African people, we've been under too long. Although my favorite proverb is that wisdom is the principal thing. So get wisdom, but in all thy getting, get understanding. Because this is Black History Month, Dr. Carter G. Woodson, the founder of it, articulated something that still needs to be re-articulated today. The mere imparting of knowledge is not wisdom, nor is it education. And because I am a computer scientist, I am speaking to you today from both the science of what is root at hand and the culture and the lived experience of this. Being a historian, today I want to set the record straight, because a lot of what you all are buying from Amazon, books like Blue Roots, that was written by an Anglo man to make money off of people trying to go on a wild goose chase to find the very burial area of our legendary and world-renowned Dr. Buzzard, that you don't know is a wild goose chase till you get to the end. Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, that created a fictional character and had a Mrs. Buzzard living in a graveyard there every night for people to come and see in Savannah, Georgia. God, Dr. Buzzard and the Belita Man, a book that was written, only put Dr. Buzzard in the title to make it sellable. Again, an Anglo woman added that to the late Cornelia Bailey's book title because they knew it would make people buy it. But Dr. Buzzard never lived in Georgia. He lived here on the Sea Islands of St. Helena Island. As soon as he came off the ships from the motherland, this is the island on which he arrived. Medicine amidst his wraps. The rest were the roots here that he harvested. And we've had three generations now of Dr. Buzzard. I know because I'm from this island. And that's why I said every time someone meets one of us, when we say we be Gullah Geechee, and they know of Dr. Buzzard, they want to know about our herbal practices. And some of you out there falsely call it hoodoo, falsely call all of it conjure. But conjure is an aspect of various things that we are going to set the record straight about today. You have to live and experience and feel spirit. So even when you say the word voodoo, that word means spirit. It has in it. In it. To have culture, you must have life. You have life, you have growth. To have root, you have to have life. And that root should not be so shallow that it could be tossed about and found by anybody that looks for it. So no, people who live the traditions that have been passed down through those who were birthed to handle the sacred, do not put it in books for everybody to use and study and use in academia and use on the internet and do these little silly videos that we've seen pop up. They don't go about it in that way. Most you'd never know exist except that the community leads you to them when necessary, because healing is in order. On this broadcast, we've done several episodes about healing now, and now about Afro-spirituality and the Gullah Geechee. And we are doing it because the Gullah Geechee are actually the living embodiment of numerous West African ethnic groups, as well as indigenous American ethnic groups. So we carry a number of traditions within our very DNA and our daily practices that when you see it, you would think it's mundane, because we don't do the Hollywoodization of it that many have accepted, to the point that we have records that have been written, like the one I played as you entered today, called Voodoo. Brother D'Angelo did that. We also have things like whole bands, one that I love, Dr. Buzzard in the original Savannah band. We danced to beat the band when that came out during the disco era. But those of us who truly knew Dr. Buzzard or know him and know what that represents did not feel that it was appropriate that someone just go about not understanding the true reality that that's not the name of a band. Voodoo is not the name of an album. These are real things, real practices, voodoo, that is an African traditional sacred order of life and lifestyle. It is the actual religion of Haiti. It is also a practice to the point where there is an entire voodoo festival in West Africa, a place that many of our Gullah Geechee ancestors came from. So 100 children, the Yeddi people, yeah, the cracky teeth say the Troy and thing like that, and Novaroo and thing like that. Yeah, you know about them for true. And most Gullah Geechees will let you know, they themselves and their families grew up in the church, grew up in the bush arbor, the brush arbor, grew up in the prayer's house. They have never turned around and done the evil aspects of things that many people are out there Googling and searching to do. It is an oxymoron to be a witch and a doctor. That's a conflict. A witch and a doctor. That's an oxymoron. It is a conflict. So when people immediately say people are witch doctors, we rebuke that in the Gullah Geechee Nation, the people of knowledge and wisdom. They rebuke that. Now, that is not to say that witches do not exist. They do exist. And if you look in biblical scripture, you find that it says, suffer not a witch to live. But now crafting, witchology, one might call it, the things that people do with Wicca, that's not our tradition. Now, you may have been forced, if you went to school in Western society, to learn about the Salem witch trials, and now there's even still celebrations of that. There are whole groups of people that practice Wicca. A lot of that goes on the side of a magic. We're not here to discuss that. We're here to discuss culture and cultural continuation in spite of assimilation and bastardization, because there was a syncretation that fought off the assimilation and the bastardization of spiritual rituals of African spirituality or Afro-spirituality. If you go to South America, if you go to the Caribbean, if you come to the Gullah Geechee Nation, you will find a syncretation of different practices that often show up in the spirit houses, end up in the church. This sound I've heard all around the world when my people did it, when the spiritual people did it. They yell it at, they come together. We crack your teeth, they yell it at, they come together. They feel that breath, that spirit, they come together. Try the spirit, by the spirit. And so a lot of you who look like me, have the same melanated skin, have gone away from who we be and have given away our golden tortoise to Western society. You somehow believe that Jesus is not African, yet born on the African continent. You don't believe that Christianity is also part of Afro-spirituality, but I'm here to tell you it is. And hence why, when you talk about Candomblé, when you talk about Santeria, when you talk about all these different practices that we don't have names for, you find that they say, oh, but it's combined with Catholic practices. It's combined with Protestant practices. It's combined with this. And it's usually socio-anthropologists that are dissecting it, because when you live something, you don't study it. And many of us who are living these true traditions ain't studying on the children with that foolishness on Twitter, on Instagram, on YouTube, and all of that, where you just buy one book, like hoodoo medicine, which is a lot of erroneous information, intentionally erroneous information that Gullah Geechee gave to someone because she was here trying to do research about our secret herbs and we didn't want that published. So they gave her misinformation. I've met her. She was very unnerved when we met. I've met a lot of people who've misrepresented Gullah Geechee culture, like Pinkney, who wrote Blue Roots. He wasn't unnerved when he met me because he's made thousands of dollars. He's living quite comfortably because people buy it because of the title on the book. But I have living books here today I have a brother who is someone who has studied under the elders, who respects the journey of having a mantle, of being able to heal others with roots, with herbs, with truth, with love, with healing hands. Some of you recognize him because you've actually seen him in films and television shows. And it's a royal show today because I'm Queen Quet, Chieftess and Head Pundit Body of the Gullah Geechee Nation. So who else would I travel with other than princes, kings? So my brother Divine Prince is going to join us now and give us greetings as I've greeted you here from Gullah Geechee Nation Coast. In the Southeast, we all are. But here I am along this end of the water in the Atlantic Ocean and hen down yonder in the Gulf Coast right there in New Orleans, where again, people go there every day looking for voodoo and hoodoo. All is a blessing to have you here to say what you do. Greetings, my brother, Divine Prince, Greek family. Peace and blessings.
And I offer you in the Yoruba, Aboru, Aboye, Abosise, Ashe. May I ever reach your rune. May I ever be accepted. May I ever allow what we desire to pass. And so we say, Ashe. And for those of you who are unfamiliar, Epo means sacrifice, to be sacrificed. And indeed, it's a sacrifice required to come into these traditions.
Yes.
Just like in Christianity, you die to the flesh and you're born again. We make a sacrifice to come into these traditions. Queen, I am honored and humbled and grateful to be here in your presence, but also in the presence of the community to share and gift this information. I often feel alone in this battle, and it is a little bit of a battle because I'm competing with the internet. I'm competing with all these book writers, all these movies and TV shows of which I am a part of. And I want to speak to that first. I'm a professional actor. I'm a professional culture performer. When I'm on my SAG card, I do what they ask within a limit. I do what they ask, but I make a clear distinction between what's authentic and what's entertainment, what's authentic and what's imagination. And as Queen has already so eloquently described, there are many people biting off, eating off our tradition today. It's an appropriation, it's a bastardization, it's a commercialization. Tourism is involved. And I'm not in conflict with tourism. We need tourism. I'm not in conflict with entertainment. We need entertainment. But don't call it the voodoo. Don't call it a con. Don't call it Yoruba. Don't call it authentic to the tradition. So I want to start by speaking just to the word voodoo. First of all, voodoo, particularly when I use it, it's a universal word, and it covers all the ethnic groups and traditions of West Africa that have made their way here to this so-called new world and now have manifested in Lukumi, Pendable, Maria Leonza in Venezuela. From here to the tip of South America, you find our roots, you find our tradition. And it's embraced by the Latin community, the Hispanic community, the Brazilian community. So the name is a little different depending on where the voodoo landed. So it's Candomblé in Brazil. It's Lukumi in Cuba. But when you get to the root of what it is, it's ethno-cultural tradition. Who you be, who you come from, who are your people? In my ministry, 50% of my ministry is ancestors. We like to say, especially today, that we acknowledge the ancestors, we respect the ancestors, we praise the ancestors. Who are they? Who are they? We call off great leaders, the Malcolm X's and the Marcus Garvey's, but who are your people? Who are your people? And so when we get to the root of what voodoo is, what Ifa is, it's an ethnic cultural tradition. When we say Ifa, when we say Alafia, when we say Ashe, we're giving homage to the Yoruba, to the Yoruba. And not all of us are Yoruba.
Right. Please say that again. That not all of us are Yoruba. All of us are Yoruba. And also with the ancestors, that's why in the Gullah Geechee Nation, we distinguish and say sacred ancestors. Because all that have gone before us are ancestors, if they left descendants back here. But are those the spirits that you want to awaken? Maybe not. That's not the energy that you want in your life. So the sacred ancestors, those of wisdom that have passed down these traditions, are who we're referring to in the libation ceremony and in the services that you were talking about. So yes, I wanted to just go ahead. Please say that again.
Some of us are Ewe. Some of us are Igbo. Some of us are Akan. Some of us are Fon. So we have to be very clear about who we are as we make our journey into these traditions. I often use sort of a shady phraseology sometimes, and I talk about the Orisha romance. The Orisha romance, that is that thirst, that hunger that we as African descendants have for our roots, for our culture. But all we know is Yoruba. All we know is Ifa. Mm-hmm. The Yoruba, and Queen will correct me if I'm wrong, are the most educated, degreed ethnic group in America. And so there are many books, many publications in English that are out there in Yoruba.
Absolutely.
And then others, Black, white, Hispanic, then take that and then rework that into their books.
Absolutely. And not only work it into their books, work it into, as you said, the tourism industry.
Yes,
as I've traveled to numerous islands around the world, I found that they have started to build a tourism component that draws people to hoping they go to certain quote unquote spiritualists in those places. And then if you hear Alafia and you turn around, it's not a person of African descent though, you see, or the person of African descent is put out front. But the person funding the building you're going to is actually this Anglo person that's actually financing it and is in the back of it. So yeah, I'm very happy that you mentioned that, because that's part of that, because Yoruba is more open to people receiving information about it. And then people have so-called studied it in universities, hence why all the publications are out there and people believe that they are truth. But I would again caution you about it. Yes, I would caution you.
Yes. And then there's that economic component. Mm-hmm. Much of what you all call Orisha, which you all think is Yoruba, which you all believe to be Ifa, which you all believe to be voodoo, hoodoo, conjure, is being fueled by economy. Your botanicas, your spiritual shops. They're in the business of selling candles, selling oil, selling product. It doesn't mean that they're qualified. It doesn't mean they know anything about the tradition, and often they don't. It doesn't mean that they've been initiated into the tradition. Their goal is to sell product. And as Queen, again, so eloquently pointed at, our thirst, our hunger for it, you're Googling for it, you're binging for it, you're searching for it online. So now on Instagram, everybody got a botanica. Everybody's a root worker. Everybody's a conjurer. And it's so pervasive that even some of our unfortunate West African relatives are now mimicking that. And so they're targeting you now. And they come at you, I'm Babalawo so-and-so. The ancestors gave me a message for you. You know, but you need to pay me some money, you know, so that I can do this process.
That's the key right there, because I've witnessed that numerous times. Yes.
And they target people like Queen Quet, like myself, like many of you in the room, because they see the interest on your profile. They see your love for Orisha on the profile. So now they're targeting us for this money, for this economy, for this foolishness. Mm-hmm. So at the base, it's about finding out who you are. Mm-hmm. I know some people find DNA to be controversial. But DNA was very powerful for me. DNA changed my evangelical Christian mother 180 degrees around when she understood we are from Ghana. She understood that we had a root in the motherland that we could actually point to. So I would first advise you to find out who you are. Talk to the older people in your family. Talk to the elders in your family. Invoke their memory. You know, Big Mama, what was it like when you were 15? What do you remember about your grandparents? We don't ask those questions anymore. And we live in a society of broken families sometimes. So when the dad's not there, you often don't know his parents and his grandparents and his relatives. And so things show up in your family, drug addiction, alcohol abuse. You know, I don't know why my son is acting this way, but you don't know the bloodline. Ancestors live in your blood. This is something our people have known since the beginning of time. Yes. Science is just now catching up to that.
Catching up to our science. The Western world science is just catching up to African science, right? Because African science knew this all along. Exactly. And part of that blood memory, because even Elder Carly Town, our Minister of Information, is here today in the audience. Greetings to you, Elder Town. We know you're in the building. And one of the things we often talk about is collective consciousness and blood memory. And what you just talked about is something that we're dealing with in the Gullah Geechee Nation now. Because, for instance, you know full well, because you and I have been in Congo Square together doing libation and drumming for our ancestors. You were there to greet me when they gave me the Queen Quet Day proclamation in New Orleans. You and the family were there to celebrate with us who we be down here and thing like that, that Guanyana, we're one of them down there on the Gulf, okay? So we are not new to this, we true to this. And you know full well that a number of people came in Congo Square to reconnect because their blood spoke. They knew they were Gullah Geechee. They were like, we've been here for two generations. But when it was announced that the queen of the Gullah Geechee was coming, we were like, dad, we family. We grind, we go did it. And we had elders there. We had spiritualists there. We had practitioners there. We had just family there, the drummers there. Everyone united in one circle is one family. But that blood smoke, and when you don't have these connections in this present generation, some of the younger generation feels that they don't need the circle. They don't need the elders. We have a situation right now where people are constantly contacting us about some younger people who are disconnected from family connection, going around with a flag, calling it a Gullah Geechee flag. There's only one flag. In the center of that flag, as you well know, is circles. And there is a tree. That tree is human bodies intertwined, inextricably tied together, but also rooted in the land, in our culture, in our traditions, one family. There's no division. And that's what spiritual people recognize. You cannot divide and unify. Again, they're on opposite ends of the spectrum, like I said with the witch and the doctor. They are oxymorons. You can't unify, divide. So you can't say, well, I'm here to want to unify or represent culture and the lived experience of that, and then do things to be divisive at the same time. So any thinking person, any seeing person, any knowing spirit tries that spirit by the spirit and recognizes it's not reality. No. And that is the one you avoid. Now, I want to bring somebody else into this discussion because the perfect timing based on what you said about going to your elders, though, to be guided in the process. And that is who we call Brudda G. Brudda G, King. That's why I tell y'all, it's a royal broadcast today. Who else the queen going to be with but the prince and the king and thing like that? And just what my brother Divine Prince just stated to you about the dialogue with your elders. I remember the day when Brudda G said to me that, well, Queen Quet, you know, I got to start practicing root. I said, why, son? That's the first question. Why? Because I know that if what he said to me, the spirit hadn't already confirmed within me, that ain't nothing he should be doing. And I get emails all the time from young people asking me about it, saying that grandma, they believe, they don't necessarily know, did it, or that they used to go with the grandma to someone and they believe, again, that this person was a conjurer or whatever term they come up with that week. And I say, well, I go into a dialogue with them. And that's the part they don't want, is the dialogue and the conversation. But ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. But you can't know if you already think you know. You can't be taught if you already think you know. And that is the crisis of the assimilation of African people in Western society. Because Western society tells you that you can be disrespectful. Look at what the United States just went through for the last 4 years. That you can be disrespectful. It doesn't matter. You can't compete. It doesn't matter. What do they say? Dog eat dog. Well, we don't eat no dog.
They say that me, myself, and I. Yeah, they say me, right. Myself, and I.
Yes, me, myself, and I, not we.
And you can't operate in isolation. There are no authentic practice in this in isolation. You have to be connected to the elders. You have to be connected to the children. You have to be connected to the family to operate authentically in these traditions. There is no me, myself, and I in the indigenous world. We understood that our survival was contingent on the family. And the family included nature. There is no voodoo without nature.
Right. So
you're burning candle wax and all kind of stuff, but you don't know anything about plants, about herbs, about trees, about roots, about healing. You're not practicing a tradition.
That's right. You are just bringing up something that, like you said, you Googled on your phone. So mm-hmm. Now, my brother Jay, what honna have a say? How honna be? What going on?
We good, Queen. How honna for do?
Oh, I do well. Look at you done dress up for the queen and all of that going on, boy. You looking good and thing like that at it.
Thank you, queen. Thank you. How you doing, Prince?
Thank you. All is a blessing.
Ayibobo.
Yeah, sit back a little bit because your head getting chopped off and we won't see that handsome face right there. There we go. Okay, then. Yeah. So yeah, we want to see your full face. So now look, young. Now you about the youngest one on this here conversation right now and thing like that. And I had Hunter come on you because it's a Hunter generation who need several switch. We need for send Hunter out for get some root, all right. But I mean some root.
I know you vex up, but I seen you talk about people love be broke up down when they sit there, they don't listen to the others. To finish the story, when I came down there with my father, because my dad was the one that was like, you know, you Gullah Geechee, you're doing spiritual work, you need to sit there and go back to that land. He said, he was the first one to say, if you don't go and acknowledge your Gullah Geechee ancestors, your magic is going to be broke up. Because it is imperative that I did that, because initially my spiritual walk was very one-dimensional. I was focused on my mother's line, which was Haitian voodoo and Creole voodoo and stuff like that. So that's where I came in. And my father said, no, you need to bring that together. Mm-hmm. And when I did my research, I realized that the connection is deep. It's a long connection. It's an old connection. Mm-hmm. You know, back when
an ancient connection.
Ancient. Yeah. You know, you look on history, Google will say, oh, Denmark Vesey and Gullah Jack were ready to start a revolution and go to Haiti. And they were killed for that. One of the biggest root workers in South Carolina was John Domingo, who actually did Gullah. He was Gullah Geechee, and he did Haitian voodoo. Mm-hmm. And again, if you look at him on Google, they're gonna make him sound like a monster, like a ghost, mm-hmm. like how they do the Buzzard. You know how they do Dr. Stephanie Robinson, who, if people understood. Dr. Buzzard was under attack by people like the FBI, CIA. It was a big thing. It wasn't a little thing. So when y'all read about him, you have to go in there with that mindset of he was an enemy to the country, basically, right? Mm-hmm. So same way you wouldn't read a book from the FBI about Asada Shakur, you would not read a book about the Buzzard from a Bukra. Mm-hmm.
Pause right there. Because one of the things that the spirit led me to write down last night was the title from Public Enemy's album, Fear of a Black Planet, for this show. And when you just said, what you said, it triggered back that I wrote that down after midnight last night, fear of a Black planet, because all of what you said was critical to this. I was just speaking with my mother about the fact that we were going to do this broadcast today. And I told her, I said, watch, it's going to be the biggest crowd I've ever had at zooming in on sustainability, because people think we're going to be entertaining them. No, I do edutainment, if anything, not entertainment. We are going to teach you truth. And I said, now, the thing about it is, just as you just said, I told her one of my favorite stories when I researched my book, St. Helena Serenity, and I wrote about Dr. Buzzard. I ain't write everything I know. I wrote enough just for y'all to consume. And I wrote about the fact that one of the greatest cases was they were always trying to try him for practicing medicine without a license. But as me and Divine just said, that's the Western world science just catching up to who we be and catching up to we African science that was the one, the first sciences on the earth. That's another story for another show. But now here it is that they were always trying to railroad him into court for practicing medicine without a license. And they'll still do it now. Yeah. And so this, but every time he won every case, until this one case. And he said, this one case, he said, oh, he's guilty. If you're entering the room now, turn off your video. This one case, it said, oh, he's guilty. And they were like, yeah, like, you know, we got him. They just ready, right? But the judge said, well, $1,000 fine or 30 days in prison. He simply reached in his pocket and counted out the $1,000 on the table and walked out. And that is one of my favorite stories about him. And the reason being is that that was also something he wanted to prove to them. That if your attempt is to keep bringing me to court to break me economically, you cannot do it. Mm-hmm. If you think that your attempt is to break me spiritually, you cannot do it. If you think that your attempt is to ruin me continuing my cultural traditions, you cannot do it. And so when you mention that about the FBI, I just wanted to confirm for people that you're not making that up, okay? That was consistent. And hence why COINTELPRO is what the term is for that. And that's a whole nother show I have to do another time, but just to feed it to you now, all right? COINTELPRO operations are still alive and sick. Yes. I am under investigation on a regular basis. They track everything I do on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. That is who is fueling the division that I'm talking about now. These churn that some of these folks is out here following online were fed information and materials from a federal organization. And so now they're going around trying to divide the Gullah Geechee Nation and go against human rights, because there's always someone who, we go back to what we already discussed in the show, it's about economics for them. It's about money. They don't care if they slit their brother, their sister, their mentor, their elder's throat, because they're trying to pimp the situation. Let's make it plain. All right?
So when y'all look up Dr. Buzzard, please also know this, because you won't find this. When Dr. Buzzard lost his most infamous case, he lost because he was so successful that if he continued to win, they would have brought Buckra in here like they did in Rosewood, like they did in Tulsa. And so Dr. Buzzard made sacrifice, said, I'm going to lose this case to protect the future of conjure men, the future of cunning women, the future root doctors, the future even hags. Even his goal was, I realize now that they're going to use me to attack my people, because again, it was a national, he was considered a national threat.
National threat.
So when y'all are reading about him and all these feats that he was doing, because what you guys know about Dr. Buzzard, they're telling y'all this because that's what they feel is comfortable. If you guys knew what he did, because root don't make you a national threat. Miracle does. When you start doing miracle, then people start looking at you like a threat.
Miracles and blessings. The manifestation is before them, especially as it relates to African people continuing to hold on to land, because Dr. Buzzard's family lives on one of the most beautiful parcels of land you ever want to see here in the Gullah Geechee Nation to this day. When you are holding on to land, you are holding on to your Africanness, you are a threat.
And Quet, can I speak to that? Can I speak to that? And he was not the only one in our history here on this land. He was not the only one. I want to start by saying we weren't taught this because it would have given you power. Anything that would have empowered us was stripped from us, taken from us. And particularly on this side of what I call the border. And so I want to speak to voodoo real quick. We say Haiti. Voodoo was in Louisiana 100 years before the Haitian Revolution. Mm-hmm. So when people tell you, well, ain't no real voodoo in New Orleans, that's not true. There were many cultural nuances to New Orleans because this has always been a major port city. So we had Spanish people here at one time. We had French people here at one time. We had people coming in from the Caribbean and absolutely coming in from West Africa. The first ship of enslaved Africans to arrive in the port of New Orleans came from Ouida, Benin. And so I like to say, if we could count in Fon, all we're doing now is being forced to learn how to count in Spanish, to learn how to count in French. And if you can count, then you can remember your drum rhythm. If you can count, then you can remember your ritual days. If you can count, you can remember what number and what product of herbs and roots need to be gathered. Now, what made the difference is the Catholic Church. A lot of people don't know this. The Catholic Church made an agreement with the Hispanic community south of the border that as long as you became Catholic, we're going to allow you on your time off to maintain your African tradition because they thought it brought unity. They thought it made them a better slave. Now, on this side of the border, we weren't allowed that. We would have been hacked, mutilated, lynched, killed, even for wanting to read, even for wanting to learn the Bible, even for wanting to go to church. So our traditions from the very beginning were forced underground. From the very beginning, we had to hide. We had to mimic. We had to appropriate Catholic saints and Christian imagery to hide our tradition. So when people say, well, you know, it's V-O-D-U. If you speak French, if you live in Haiti, And I chose to stick with four O's to make the clear distinction between Louisiana and French-speaking nations. So we've always had the voodoo here. Now, people talk about names in terms of bastardization. At one point, we couldn't say voodoo in New Orleans. You still can't say voodoo in New Orleans around And then the white community, and some people blame Marie Laveau for this, started its practice. So that's when hoodoo came about to separate what they were doing from what we were doing.
From what you were doing, right.
So if a black person back in the day said, oh, they practicing hoodoo, they were being shamed. They were saying that you didn't sold out. But that is not the base of the tradition. So when we say conjure, when we say root work, you know, we are really finding less threatening terminology. And in that process, we're bringing in corruption. We're bringing in appropriation. People think it's pagan. People now think it's witchcraft. I get emails every day from Asian people saying, well, I'm white, can I do voodoo? And my answer is always, well, beloved, let me see your DNA. Get your DNA done and let me look at your DNA. That usually ends the conversation.
There's
no argument after that. So I wanted to make that distinction. I'm happy you did.
I'm happy you did because that goes to what I wanted Brother Jay to talk about as well, because he has both sides of the family thing going. And I know I've also seen you online trying to clarify these same things that Divine Prince has eloquently stated, that there is a big difference. There are connections, but there's also a very big difference between Haitian voodoo and then Louisiana hoodoo and then what you call low country conjure. That ain't my thing to call it that, but I've seen you call it that. So I want you, for this audience, to hear what's the distinction between those three things, according to what your family has passed down, since you have Haitian ancestry and lineage?
Okay, so one, first I want to start off with the Low Country conjure. I want everybody to understand something, because Queen Quet also made history when she brought Gullah Geechee together. It was not before, it was not done. Even if you look in old books, if you can find them, and you're gonna have to look in encyclopedias and old stuff like that, there were so many different ways they would break us up: salt water, fresh water, highland, all this other stuff. And most of my family comes from St. Simon and Sakwa. So even to go back, that's why when the queen was telling everyone about ancestors, it's true. Because I can't go back and call my St. Simon ancestors, because the first Africans to come there that became Gullah Geechee were part of the Igbo landing. So I'm not gonna call my ancestors who drowned themselves, you know, to assist me, because that energy is gonna be so much, right? It could overtake me. And I don't have a reference for that time period, because I don't have an elder who has a reference for that type of, you know, ability. So that is very important. That's very important that people understand that was also a monumental moment in itself, the bringing together, so that there was no more division. So now when we talk about Haitian voodoo and Louisiana hoodoo, the common ancestor is in Dahomey. It is in the Ouida. That's where there were some that went to Haiti and there were some that came here. A lot of people feel like during the Haitian Revolution, Haitians came to Louisiana. That is not true. They share an ancestor in the Africans and also in the Arawak Indians, which people love to forget about, but there were so many different indigenous tribes that were active, that were moving, that were sailing, that were trading. Louisiana was one of the biggest ports, and so were the Sea Islands. So there was a long history of relationship long before colonization, for the record. Mm-hmm. That's very important that people understand that too. Like the connection did not happen when conflict happened. It was an established relationship, which is why during those revolutions, those relationships were able to be maintained and sustained. They were already established.
Absolutely. That's why in Savannah, there's a Haitian statue in Savannah, because the Haitian soldiers came to help fight in Savannah because of what you're saying, because of that ongoing connection and link between our islands and our families and the traditions. Yeah.
And Queen, I also wanted to speak to what you were saying about the practitioner among the Gullah Geechee who had the land and was under threat. And I said that was not a singular event. And one that is real popular right now is Aunt Julia Brown. Aunt Julia Brown. And we know about her supposedly cursing the swamps, wiping out three towns here in Louisiana, just north of New Orleans, by way of a hurricane. She was accused of threatening the town. She was a hoodoo practitioner. She was a healer. She was a doula. She was a midwife. But what they don't tell you is that she and her husband are one of the few actually documented enslaved or formerly enslaved Africans who received the 40 acres and a mule. Mm. So they had the 40 acres, and she was a major landlord in the area of Frenier and Red Louisiana. But she felt used, she felt taken advantage of, and we can only imagine the threats to their wealth, the threats to their land from the surrounding community, both white and black, because we still had enslaved Africans during that time who were doing the bidding of their master. And you had master who were, you know, feeling some kind of way about them owning all this wealth. So her husband died within a year of them receiving the 40 acres and a mule. And then she died within a year after that. Now, they don't tell us how or why, if they were sick, if they were, you know, we don't get that information. Right. We just get the scary Hollywood entertainment element. And when you come here to do the swamp, that's one of the places that they take you. So I made a connection there when I heard you talk about, you know, the wealth behind the healers. Mm-hmm. We often think about it as you know, this impoverished old lady, old man at the house at the end of the road. Mm-hmm. But you got to have produce. You got to have farmland. You got to have access to pigs and goats and sheep. For these people, even in terms of slavery, were never poor, were never without resources. And so that also made them a threat in the community. Too much power.
Yeah, too much power. And that's why they call Gullah Geechees a lot of times land rich and cash poor, because they look at all these acres and acres of land that we still own, and they want to deny us economic opportunity through other means. But as long as you have land, you can feed yourself. I think this pandemic has taught a lot of people why I dedicate my life to Black land ownership, okay? Yes. And so now I wanna go to that, because I wanna go right back to Brother Jay about Haiti, because they're in the Western world, there is a hatred for Haiti because of revolution, because they own their own country, right? Because they then said, no, all you Europeans gonna either leave or die. We are not going to let you continue to enslave us, and we will own our land. And as a result, they've tried to ensure their death. And what I mean by that is by the Western world deciding we're going to not give resources them, we're not going to do economic global trade with them, and try to cut off that continuing connection that you mentioned happened prior to colonization and enslavement. And we see the same thing with Cuba. We see the same thing with Cuba, right? That it's like, no, when President Obama came in and said, yes, it's no problem, the gates are open, we're gonna deal with Cuba. Our Gullah Geechee sister there, Asada Shakur, I was all ready to go on down there and be like, give the hugs, finally get to see you in person, let's do it. And here we go. Soon as administration changed, nope, we gonna make sure that's one of the first things we stop. It's none of that. And why? All of these places and spaces have been independent. All these places have been people of African descent, and are people of African descent, that still hold on to their spiritual traditions and their land, their land. Look at the amount of doctors and healers that Cuba has been able to send around the world every time there is a hurricane. I want to bring it back to what you just brought up, all right? A hurricane, a tropical storm. Who came to help save their own people again was our Afro-Cuban family, our Cuban family, our island family. So I want to go back to you, Brother Jay, right where you were, and kind of pick up there.
All right. Well, I know a lot, I get into problems with this all the time when I talk about land, you know, and they'll call me everything from this to that to Jeff Bezos to capitalists and all that. But when I talk about land, I talk about the importance, because our adversary understands the, you know, the issue. You know what I mean? They understand how powerful land is and how it's important. When you cause unrest in the land, you cause disgratitude in the land, you make it so that people can't, you know, people can't enjoy the land or learn the land or work the land, you remove them from their inheritance when you cut them from the root. Mm-hmm. They only, you know, they have an expired life. And in Haiti, you see that a lot even now. You know, there's gold, there's coffee, there's sugar, but people, I personally feel like a plan to keep the people away from utilizing the land for their benefit. And when you think about the hurricane stuff, and whenever we have issues with the Black community, we always end up being the ones who have to take care of each other. We have to send our stuff. Flint still don't got no water. If it's not us that's gonna do it, it's not gonna get done. And I think you look at the Gullah Geechee history, the Haitian history, even Louisiana, because, you know, if it wasn't for elders like PrinceTy, people would be coming into Louisiana, bringing in their energy, absorbing the energy, taking from it, desecrating it. That's why we need our elders to kind of manage those energies and say, okay, well, now we need to put a boundary here or set up a block here. Because these adversaries, they know. If we pour our poison into the land, we can get rid of them.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, if we attack the heart of the revolutions, if we attack the heart of the Black revolutions, the Louisianas, the Haitis, the Africas, the Low Countries, we don't even have to attack them all, right? If you right. get them at the heart, you don't even have to do one by one. You know, they understand now.
Right. And they've been using the same tactic all along. I mean, we're talking about over 400 years of colonization. Mm-hmm. And so when you have people with colonized minds that really think that they are in ownership of their own thoughts, herein lies the problem. As I said earlier, and many of you, some people just arrived now, many of you may not be aware, I'm a computer scientist by degrees, a computer scientist and mathematician by degrees, all right? So it is critical to me that I make it clear to you, I do not keep a cell phone on me all the time. I do not keep a cell phone powered on most of the time. And if you watch even this Netflix documentary, Social Dilemma, you will realize why you shouldn't either. Because we, as programmers, as computer scientists, said over 30 years ago, we were going to shrink the computer, which used to be the size of buildings, down so people could have it in their hand. That's what you have now. That's not a cell phone. It's a PDA. It's a personal digital assistant. And what it's assisting you to do is think what it wants you to think. Why do you think all those notifications are available to you? So that you are constantly distracted and so that you're drawn to whatever it's doing. So it's programming you. You're not programming it, you see? And you give yourself away willingly into the slavery that comes with being connected to that device, comes with being connected to Google and Bing. So you go and you disconnect from the circle of the sacred, and you are not under the oak tree, you're not in the bush arbor, you're not in the hush arbor with the elders and the sacred people and the people of vision, where you can get overstanding, where you can learn. These are only little, one might call, breadcrumbs that we left y'all to bring you into the circle today. We don't even have an entire year to spend with all of you to share all of the history and the truth behind all of the links, but we wanted to share at least enough that gets you to realize the reality of Afro-spirituality. Whether you use any of the names you've heard us say today, for folks who have the ability to take herbs, to take what some people call root and use it to heal, they can do that. They also could opt to use it to kill. So let us not let the electronic device become your new root, that you actually are getting killed and killing with it because you've been programmed to do it. They no longer have to send people out in cars or on horses with hoods at night if you are going to do the character assassination and the killing of your own culture and community and of your own people. But guess what? That which ye sow, ye shall also reap. Once again, that which ye sow, ye shall also reap. That is universal law.
Yeah.
So if your intent is negative, that negativity will be seen on you.
Multiple.
And in you. It will manifest in your life. It's not that it'll manifest in the other one's life. It will manifest in your life. If your intent is to heal and be a healer, healing, abundance, this glow of power and energy and true prosperity, spiritual prosperity, is what is going to manifest in you and in your life. And there's nothing but love you'll find. Everywhere that I have visited, many of the places that have meant places we mentioned today, I visited. If I haven't visited there, the people have come and visited me here in the Gullah Geechee Nation. I've been embraced. I have never met any of our people of the African diaspora that rejected me. Everyone has always embraced me.
That's my experience. Yes.
Yes. And so when the Divine Prince and I connected with his statement, all is a blessing, I said, this is such truth. At least that is my living truth. Yes. All is a blessing. You see? And so when we start to look at providing blessings to others, there's nothing else that can happen but blessings to come back. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction along the same line. So you try it, you try back at home. If you're trying to circle, it gwine right, it coming back. And guess what? It usually has momentum. So you would watch what you say. You will watch what you put out there and watch what you take in as well. That's what we really wanted to sit here as truth tellers, as people that are respected in our communities, because we still live amongst our elders and respect them. We still live amongst other healers that mentor us. We respect them. We literally can walk out our homes and go and pick what we need for healing like that at it. Okay, I ain't ordered that off no internet. Okay, I ain't Googling that. I don't have to. Okay, so that's the thing. I know a lot of you are saying, my elders didn't tell me the language and my elders didn't pass down stuff. Look, y'all. That is the same thing we've been a crack we teeth out at the beginning. And so some of Hunter chilling might not deal, and I've been a crack we teeth Alicia, but I gotta say them again. The no man's child don't taste no grace. A lot of you cannot get elders, even if it's your mom and your daddy, to talk to you about your culture, about your traditions, or tell you anything, because they see within you a spirit of arrogance, self-entitlement, and ego. And ego is etching God out. They also realize spiritually and with your emotional quotient, your emotional intelligence, you are not yet at the point in life where sacred things can be passed on to you. Mm-hmm. They say when the student is ready, the teacher appears.
Yes.
When the student is ready, the teacher appears. They didn't say the student go dig up on Google and Bing and they'll find all they're going to get. That's not the truth. And that's why with Brother Jay, I wanted to make sure that he was here, not just to hear the discussion, but as a person of the next generation to be able to speak even, because he is someone who, as you heard him say, his daddy told him. And what did he do? He obeyed his daddy. See, at the beginning, Divine Prince mentioned sacrifice. Biblical scripture lets you know obedience is greater than sacrifice. Say it again. Obedience is greater than sacrifice. You have to be obedient to gain the type of insight, wisdom, knowledge, and much less understand it, as I say, overstand it, of the kinds of traditions that we are talking about yet live on in the motherland, yet live on in the Gulf Coast, yet live on here in the Gullah Geechee Nation, yet live on throughout the Caribbean or Caribbean, depending on who the cracky teeth about them and things like that. But there is central to it, family, the circle of the family, respecting the family. And that's the global African family. So as I said at the beginning, if you came to this show to be entertained, this wasn't the place for you to be today. If you came to this today because you're writing a paper, I advise you not to do that, because this is not for that. And see, when something else happened to you, please don't email me, and please don't contact Divine Prince, don't contact Brother Jay, don't contact any of us about what illness you're suffering and headaches you're getting and whatever else happened to you, because this is not for that. This is not for your intellectual stimulation. This is for spiritual enlightenment and for us to lead you to knowledge. But as I said to the brothers today, like they say, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make them drink. Well, you can lead a man or woman to knowledge, but you can't make them think. Now, the spiritual people think, though. Think. Think with this. Think with this. Everything is on the tree of life, but there is also a reaction to everything. You have a choice. What is the seed that you are sowing? What is the reason that you are on the internet, or, you know, in your neighborhood, or passing out flyers, or where you are putting out information saying you're some sort of practitioner, you're some sort of priestess? Who initiated you? What elders actually looked on you and said that they could see this gift? Because if you don't carry the gift, it might unwrap on its own and release something that you don't want. And I'm telling you what I know, I know people right now with mental problems and spiritual problems because they mishandled the sacred. Mm-hmm. And so I'm saying to you, don't do it. That's why you saw that the name of this show is Root and Hand. We'll say, my hand be did it. Hand be did it. Why go on, you want to forget the hand? When they go and forget a hand, they don't mean they want somebody's hand chopped off. Stop that zombie foolishness y'all see on a Hollywood film. That's not what they're going to do. What they want is they want someone to give them that hand that's going to heal. And they know where the person who's gifted with that, who emotes that kind of energy, goes to. Again, the Bible will tell you, send for the elders when someone is sick amongst you. And then you do laying on of hands, but I don't want everybody touching me. Just because they're a preacher, they can say they're a minister, whatever. I'm telling you, I can stand in a praise house, I stand in a church, and they put oil on somebody's hand, and I already read that spirit. I've been doing that from the time I've been here, and know that person is demonic as they come. They are evil, their heart ain't right, they only up front because they want people to look at them. That person is not going to lay hands on me because I don't want that energy to transfer. Everything within a plant is life-based. Mm-hmm. So it has energy. That energy passes on into other life if you ingest a tea or you take a herbal bath or you do any of that. So that's why it's so important that you recognize that. Don't just be going and getting the herbs from anybody and anywhere. Because you could be bringing that energy into your home and then into yourself.
But Queen Quet, come on. They buying herbs that was grown 5 years ago. They buying incense that was dipped 10 years ago in India, you know, and it's dried up and lost all its power. And as you were saying, we've lost a respect for nature. We've lost a respect for the land. Many of you all's parents, because y'all are probably, some of y'all are younger than me, many are older. You know, grandma passed down the land, y'all sold it off.
Mm-hmm. Or let it go up for tax auction. Yeah. I ain't going down there in the country. Yeah.
Or you got land and you got green grass full of pesticides and herbicides and chemicals. You don't grow anything. You don't, I can pick fruit off my tree in my yard. I can pull sugar cane out of my yard. And I have two gardens, community gardens on my block. Okay, so what ain't growing in my yard is growing around this corner or around that corner. We've lost our connection. And Queen was talking about the devices. You know, now you can Uber it. Now you can Instacart it, you know, and you can get all the worst, you know, fake food in the world delivered right to your door. And so you can't expect to think clearly, to vibrate openly, and to
connect. They don't even call it food, though. It's food-like substances. They call it food-like substances. That's actually how they classify it at the FDA, but go ahead.
Mm-hmm. I call it fake food, you know, fake food. And I'm not here to bash any brands, but it's fake. I don't eat pre-made. I don't eat pre-packaged. I don't go fast food. I really don't mess with a restaurant unless I know the people there and how they prepare and like where they get their food from.
That's, you know, right.
I go to the farmer's market. I go to the old man that's got a truck that just drove out of the country full of watermelon, full of cantaloupe. You know, much of the produce you're getting in the major box stores, it's not real. If it don't have seeds, it ain't real.
It ain't real. GMO, right, exactly. Genetically modified organism, notice that. And I'm glad you brought up land because I know we're over time and I always love when we go over time. That means that an audience is still here. That means that this is such vital food we're serving. Nobody wants to leave the table because they're getting full. So I want to just mention right now that because we've been talking so much about land and my stand for land and the Gullah Geechee Sea Island Coalition responses this broadcast is stand for land. We are still fighting to hold on to Gullah Geechee land. As you've heard us mention, there's this constant onslaught and battle to remove us from the land. Why not? If we remove you from the land, we'll get access to your herbs. I've had many people in the medical community try to see if they could partner with me to make these so-called botanicals and things like that. And I said, I refuse because that is anti my spirit and that is anti my community and the things that that are sacred, we need to keep within our circle. So if you all have appreciated the work we're doing here and you want to help us continue, I've already dropped the various ways that you can find us and connect with us. Go to GullahGeecheeNation.com, GullahGeecheeNation.com. Follow the Gullah Geechee Nation Facebook fan page. Follow at Gullah Geechee on Instagram and on Twitter. It's GullahGeechee. Ain't a no I in Geechee if it a we. Okay? So, and the Gullah Geechee Sea Island Coalition is at GullahGeechee.net. For those who want to donate to the Gullah Geechee Land and Legacy Fund, that is an ongoing fund to fight legal battles to ensure that we remain on our land and that people can continue their traditions, including the healing herb traditions, because they've illegalized some of the herbs that are native to the Gullah Geechee Nation that we use in healing practices. There's a federal law against us having one. I'm not going to even say what it is. That ain't none of y'all business. But also, it is very difficult to find. Hang on 1 minute. And so I ain't telling them.
I was going to say, don't forget to tell them about the fact that the war is so bad. Understand something? They have a building, a place on St. Simon, where they deal with the finances of the country. On Morgan Island, they out here working with cures and all this other stuff. So they're using the illegal herbs, right? The illegal herbs.
Yeah, so-called.
Sit there and work on their biological warfare against our people, with us people being the test dummies they're using on. So it's so much bigger than just a pipeline here and a museum there. It is real war.
It's a real war. It's very insidious. So as I was saying to the folks, if y'all want to support the effort, you can go to GoFundMe. You will find the Gullah Geechee Land and Legacy Fund there. GoFundMe, Gullah Geechee Land and Legacy Fund. You'll see a video with me that'll explain to you all these legal battles that we're constantly in. If you do Cash App, you can simply do $ Gullah Geechee Nation, $ Gullah Geechee Nation. Again, Gullah is G-U-L-L-A-H, Geechee is G-E-E-C-H-E-E, and then Nation, N-A-T-I-O-N. So I definitely want y'all to be able to know we don't just do these show by long so and thing like that. There is an effort and an onslaught to work against us. Remember I mentioned equal and opposite reaction? Okay. And so everything that's on the tree of life, everything is also in scales. Things have to balance. So while we're doing positive things, there are those doing negative things. While we're at peace, somebody is waging war, as you're hearing here. So go ahead, my brother Divine Prince. Go ahead.
I hope I'm not the first person to tell you this, but we're in a battle right now for Congo Square. Mayor Cantrell and a few others want to put City Hall in Armstrong Park. And so there's a building there, a municipal auditorium that has sat unused for years. And they want to move City Hall into this small building. And so that's a threat to this 600-year-old tree in Congo Square. And all the baby trees that's connected to it that are 200-300 years old, it's a threat to them tearing up the sacred land that we know as Congo Square, which every few decades has been reduced. Mm-hmm. And so now they want what's left of it. So we're in a war here as well. We're in a battle here as well to maintain and protect our sacred land. It's going to affect my neighborhood, which is the first Black suburb in America, historic Treme. It's going to affect our community. So I get it. They're in a battle for our lives, for our very lives. And as long as we keep playing these games, these hoodoo games and these witchcraft games and not appropriately applying our power and connecting to our ancestors, we're going to lose this thing.
Absolutely. The link in the chat for you for the Gullah Geechee Land and Legacy Fund. And again, you can donate at $ Gullah Geechee Nation. And remember to follow we at GullahGeecheeNation.com. And all of you, this show will rebroadcast on GullahGeechee.tv. GullahGeechee.tv. So go there, subscribe for free. You'll also find several other episodes where we've talked about herbology, we've talked about Afro-spirituality, we've talked about healing our community and our family and our land and continuing to stand. So if you continue to follow me, then you know this, your fight ain't over. The Gullah Wars never ended. Right. And again, the first time that term was ever coined was in my book, The Legacy of Igbo Landing. And you can obtain a copy. I already dropped in the chat, GullahGeechee.biz, GullahGeechee.biz, if you want to become a member of the Gullah Geechee Sea Island Coalition and stand with us in this fight. You can definitely go there and pay membership dues and find out more about the coalition at GullahGeechee.net. And my brothers, I know a lot of folks hung in here that usually are here for the 1 hour, and we're going into about an hour and a half, and we could be going into 1 day and a half easily with the three of us here, especially if we've been underneath that oak tree and things like that. Okay, look, y'all, going up in the bush on anything. They just ain't know that, until they know, bring that drum. They ain't know nothing about that. But yeah, so what I want to do with Brother Jay, I want you to give some final words to the family, some words of insight and wisdom in regard to this. And then we're going to let Brother Divine Prince give his final words and definitely tell them how they can reach you if they want to connect with you as well.
All right. Well, Queen, Prince, thank you guys for, you know, I told you guys already, like, this a moment for me. And if I want anybody to take anything from this, understand that our elders are necessary, right? And we, the power that we have, it's not just for the sake of having it. It comes with a reason, right? So you are only entitled to power if you are willing to submit yourself to service, right? So it is imperative that if you are willing to take this walk, then you have to be willing to serve, because that's the way. There's no cheat code, there's no way around it. All right. And so our elders, they went through this stuff for us. And if you missed it, when I decided to get into root hoodoo conjure, because what I call it publicly, it's for y'all to get what I'm talking about. When I'm doing it, I'm calling it something else. I'm speaking something else. What I give for y'all is something that, you know, it's palatable. You have to listen and you must heed. You must heed. And I think that's what I'm glad I'm here, because I want people to understand that. I didn't get here because I read a book. I had to listen. And then my dad took me to the queen, and my queen took me to the prince. I had to listen. So I didn't get it in a year. Maybe it took 5 years, but I'd rather get it right than get it fast. So that's what I hope. If you take anything from that, that's what I want. People that are on the spiritual walk, that are in this for real, that are in this for reconciliation of spirit and ancestry, do the work. Do the work. And it will be worth it. I'm on Twitter. Isms has risen. IZMS has risen. I'm also on Instagram. Jayisms. JAYIZMS. I will probably be commenting on this on GullahGeechee.com. So when you get on there and you see the video, I'm probably gonna comment on it. So if you need my information, I'll get back on that.
Absolutely. Excellent. And with all of what you said, with that work, doing the work comes responsibility. And definitely Divine Prince, I know you have carried that mantle and this responsibility for quite some time. You've studied amongst the greats, amongst many people, because again, you listen and you are still listening. So please, at this time, speak and share with the family some words of wisdom and let them know.
You never stop listening. You never stop learning. You never stop being open to spirit. That's the first thing. It's not in a book. It's not in a two-week initiation. It's not in a year-long initiation. It's a lifelong journey. As I said earlier in the show, there is no voodoo without nature. There is no con, fun, God, anyway, without nature. And so reacquaint yourselves with nature. If you're eating BS, you can't expect your brain to function at its optimum. You can't expect your power to manifest at its optimum. And so we have to pay attention to what we're eating, what we're feeding our families, what we're feeding our children, what we're allowing to be fed to us, literally and figuratively. Pay attention to what you're taking into your ears and into your eyes. sometimes all this extra studying and looking ain't always good. You will find yourself on the witchcraft website. You will find yourself reading a book that's got some nonsense mixed in there. And there are jinn attached to all of this practice and this tradition. And they're waiting for that opportunity to exploit you and take advantage of you. I can be reached here in New Orleans. Listen, I'm everywhere. You can Google The Divine Prince and I'm on probably every social media network. But you can also visit my website at www.houseofthedivineprince.com. And my YouTube is voodootye, V-O-O-D-O-O-T-Y-E. Reacquaint yourself with nature. Reacquaint yourself with the ancestors. Reacquaint yourself with the elders. Reach out to the oldest people in your family. I don't care if you haven't talked to them in years. Reach out to your oldest cousins, your oldest aunties, and ask them about their experience. Jog their memory. What was being 5 like for you? What was being 10 like for you? You'll be surprised how opening that type of communication can be with the elders in your family. And it will give you that opportunity that the three of us have had to really reconnect with our root and then have something to carry. You have to have a foundation, and the ancestors are the foundation. And without a strong foundation, you're destined to fall.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so we did this show today because of the love we have for our people, our community, our African family globally, especially for all 100 children, with the Gullah Geechee and thing like that. The one with D down in the Gulf, the one with D in the Gullah Geechee Nation, the one that in the Gullah Geechee diaspora. We got love for you, and we want truth to be presented to you at all times, because we want you to be the next generation to hold on to traditions, but know why those traditions exist and what's the intent behind them. And so today I want to close out with a scripture that I know a lot of you in this room, because you are here, because you want and you love spirituality, you want to know more about it. You probably get into numbers, and you know numbers have their own meaning. And as a mathematician, you know I love numbers. And so when I looked at the numerology of a particular scripture, it turned out that the number for it would turn out to be a 3. All right, so we have the Trinity. And that told me it was a blessing, and that I was to definitely read it to you, because I want to make sure I know it, but I want to read it, because I want y'all to realize reading is also critical. Y'all come say you want a reading? That's a critical word in regard to what we're talking about. And so people could read you, okay, and then tell you, no, that's not what you were to do. And when you go against what they have just said to you as people of wisdom, then you have to deal with the outcome and the fallout, and usually it's the fallout. And so I say to you this, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Therefore, choose life that both thou and thy seed may live. You can't have root and neither the tree without the seed. So this your day upon this your journey. We wanted to give on a little bit of the seed of who we be. Right here underneath this your Gullah Geechee tree. And Hunna must take care of the root for heal the tree. Otherwise, in the future, where we gonna be? Yeah, day, yeah, tall, tall. And if you don't yet all the truth, on a sure why fall. So this year the Queen Quet, head upon the body of the Gullah Geechee Nation. I so glad that all 100 children taught them not robbery, but take this your spiritual journey with we today. For crack we teeth, but this your thing about the root, the hand, and the Gullah Geechee land. Thank you, thank you. This been truly a royal discussion. And as we said at the beginning, in all true life, we walk the words of the Divine Prince. All is a blessing. So peace and blessings to all the family. Stay safe, stay healthy, everybody.
Ashe, Ashe, oh.